today we're in Exodus 19 and 20. And there's a part of this that isn't my forte. However, there's a part of it that it is right in my wheelhouse. Fieldhouse, where I use my wheelhouse. Okay. We're talking about these Ten Commandments. And this is huge. This is huge in the life of the nation, and it's huge for us today. And there's a lot of discussion of what these things are and how they work in our lives today. That's actually a headache. We're going to save some time for that just because that's a bigger one. Chapter 18, last week what we did was we worked our trip down to Sinai. And we ran out of water a couple times, or the water was just a little bit not tasting good. So we invented some charcoal filters, put them in the water, and everything worked out. We even got attacked by the Amalekites. Do you remember that? But, you know, if you lift up your hands, this is the sign for surrender for us. We lifted up Moses' hands, and as long as Moses' hands were lifted up, the army of Israel prevailed. And we took away some remembrance from these events. The end of chapter 18, I'm skipping, but this is that encounter with Jethro. And remember, Jethro comes to Moses, and do you remember his advice to Moses? Yeah, okay. Moses, you're carrying too much weight here, and you need to. And so Moses did. He divided things up into groups, into subgroups, into sub-subgroups, and et cetera, to begin to facilitate all this judging that he had to do. He felt like he had to hear every single case, and so. But I'm moving past that one to get to 19 and 20. Because this is a very special event that happens, and I want to spend our time here just to kind of nail down how special it is. I've got the lesson into two parts. Chapter 19, I'm calling the chapter Up and Down the Mountain. That's not the name of the lesson. That's just the chapter. Moses is going to get a workout. He's moving up and down the mountain several times. Like, okay, what do you want me to say? Okay, this is what he said. Okay, well, you tell him. Okay, up, down, up, down. And so up and down the mountain. And then chapter 20, the Ten Commandments. Okay, let's begin at chapter 19, verse 1. In the third month, after the Israelites left Egypt, on the very day they came to the desert of Sinai, after they set out from Rephidim, they entered the desert of Sinai, and Israel camped there in the desert in front of the mountain. And this is a significant mountain. Verse 3. Then Moses went up to God, and the Lord called to him from the mountain and said, "This is what you are to say to the house of Jacob, what you are to tell the people of Israel." So the stage is set. We're about to hear God's, again, perspective, his take on the special situation that they're in. Listen to these words from God. This is what you're to say. "You yourselves have seen what I did to Egypt and how I carried you on eagle's wings and brought you to myself." Can you hear? I know you understand what these words mean, but can you hear the personal nature of God here? That is, God is someone, he is a person, and we're talking about things of intimacy, closeness, special regard in this language. "I brought you to myself. I carried you on eagle's wings." We'll talk about those eagles in just a second. Verse 4. That's where we're saying. Verse 5. "Now, if you obey me fully and keep my covenant, then out of all the nations, you will be my..." What do you guys have here?
Treasure.
Special treasure, treasured possession. Are you feeling the personal nature of that? Not I'm going to be indifferent to you. Not I'm going to surround myself with so many requirements that you'll be caught up in red tape if you ever wanted to communicate with me. It's not that. This is, you are my treasured possession. Like, we own a lot of things, and then in the secret compartment, we have a place for our treasures. That's what you guys are, okay? You're my treasured Israel. You're going to be my treasured possession. There's two things. Let's keep going. The second half of verse 5. Although the whole earth is mine, you will be a kingdom of priests. You will be a holy nation. These are the words you're to speak to the Israelites. Look at that. That is profound. That is huge. That is God, the maker of heaven and earth. That is God, faithful to Abraham's, the promise he made to Abraham. That is God who by his mighty hand brought Israel out, brought them to this mountain, and notice the language. You're my treasured possession. I carried you to myself. You will be a kingdom of priests. All of the nations, you're going to be the holy nation. Okay? You can't overestimate. You can't out-approximate the largeness of what God is describing his people. The personal closeness that he is wanting to do by uniting with them via a covenant. Okay, does everyone understand what I'm saying? This is huge. This is, the thing I'd liken that unto would be the day you come to Christ. The day that you confess Jesus Christ is Lord and you find yourself to be born anew, a new creation with a God who will never leave you nor forsake you. It is a huge thing, and it's on this national scale. Let me just look at a couple of those phrases. They're going to be a kingdom of priests. But don't forget, we probably need to figure out how to understand that phrase, because the whole nation isn't going to be the priests. They have priests. But when you look at the world at large and all of the nations at large, this one nation is going to serve as some sort of mediator between the rest and God. There's a special position there. We do see this phrase in the book of Peter when Peter describes the church. He calls us a kingdom of priests. But even that works differently. Each of us individually are the one who stands between whomever we're talking to or for and God. The nation has been elevated to a position where they're going to be in a special relationship as a priest for all the nations of the earth. Notice how that worked in the end of verse 5. Although the whole earth is mine, you will be a kingdom of priests. Okay? So special position. Let's talk about these eagle's wings. Okay? I just want to say that with respect to last week's class. God says, I brought you to myself on eagle's wings. Okay? What was last week about? There was a little grumbling, complaint. Were there any reasons to grumble or complain? Well, we're in a desert and we have no water. Is that first class eagle's wings? Or is that like you're in the back of the plane? Sorry, we already gave all the food away. It was a rough trip. They even got attacked by the Amalekites. This is eagle's wings. Okay? Now, I just want, by way of application, I just want you to see, sometimes we see this, and God's doing this. You know, let's rewind. Let's pretend you didn't have no quail or no water, no sweet water. Let's pretend you didn't have that. Well, let's see. Let's take it back a while. How far should we push it back? Let's go to Egypt, where you were slaves, where you were working for some men, a nation. And then in the middle of that, they also took away the very thing to help you accomplish what you were doing for them. Okay? How far back do we got to go? God's perspective on this transition, I brought you here on eagle's wings. Okay? A treasured possession to myself, a holy nation, a kingdom of priests. This is huge, and I just do that slow and rehearse it for you, because the relationship between Israel and God is about to turn a corner. And this is the language that God is putting in front of them. And they're going to respond to this language. Any question? Any question? Okay, good. I didn't think there would be, but look at verse 7. So Moses went back and summoned the elders of the people and set before them all the words the Lord had commanded him to speak. The people all responded together. We will do everything the Lord has said. So Moses brought this answer back to the Lord. Okay, so this is good. Moses goes to the elders. And evidently the elders have the pulse of the nation. They check their polling data. It sounds like everyone's in on this one. And you know polling data is never wrong. So, okay. The people all responded together. That's the language we get in verse 8. We will do everything the Lord has said. Okay? Now, that's legitimate. That's good. I think that's a proper response. I don't think we need to read into this their imperfections or their grumbling or complaining. God has said something special to these, and they are responding, and they are responding the right way. This is a good thing. I want to remind you of something. God has already proven faithful to his covenant promise. He's already proven faithful to bring Israel out of Egypt. That's what he promised. He did that. But you're seeing something special here. You don't want to miss it. God is under no obligation to enter in a covenant relationship with Israel. He has already met. If he, as it were, walks away from the table, that's okay. He rescued his people. We're getting a ramped up situation that God would now prepare to set up a covenantal relationship with them. And he does so by A, appealing to them in light of what he's accomplished for them. And they're seeing it, and they're responding in kind, properly, right-headed so. But we're moving now into, notice that language, we will do everything. All right, let's find out what the everything is. I got 10 things for you in just a second, what the everything is going to entail. Are you following? That's a very special place. God is free to do as he pleases. And it's clear this is his pleasure. It is clear this is his pleasure. I brought you to me. I brought you so that you as a nation could serve as a go-between between all the nations of the earth. They're all mine, but you will be the kingdom of priests, Israel. You will serve in that special function. So they say yes. So that means Moses goes right back up the mountain and tells, hey, they're good with this. Two thumbs up. Let's get going. Verse 9. The Lord said to Moses, all right, then I'm going to come to you in a dense cloud so that the people will hear me speaking with you and will always put their trust in you. Okay. You guys see Moses getting elevated here? I'm going to talk with you, and they're going to get it. Remember, at the end, they're going to be saying stuff. No, you go. He talks to you. You talk with him. I mean, there's going to be fear and dread. Okay. You remember, I'm about to read it, but do you remember any of the characteristics about this mountain that's going to happen when the Lord comes? Do you remember any of the ways the mountain is described?
smoke around it.
Smoke, yes.
And cloud.
Cloud, thunder, lightning. They are going to be afraid. The Lord's going to do that to test them. But I want you to see something that's really neat. It's not thundering and the cloud and lightning, nor is there that sharp horn that is blasting constantly through. There's no fear or dread. That's not what is happening. They're responding to the fact that God reminded them, this is what I did for you. I brought you out of Egypt. I carried you here to myself on eagle's wings. You're going to be my treasured possession, a holy nation and a kingdom of priests. We accept. Sometimes I think when I want to get a point across, I use more bombast. Have you seen my bombast yet? Okay. We use that. We know we see it. We see it in Hollywood. You know, you're just not going to get this is what I'm thinking. You're not going to get the still small voice. You need the thunder. You need the lightning. You need the power to substantiate the legitimacy of this offer. And what we had that personal, special appeal. And they've responded. They don't know the thunder and lightning's coming. Okay? So I want you to see where they are. They're not scared into this. They're not frightened into this. They're about to be frightened because they need to know who the Lord is. They need their side of the equation to be ramped up to meet God's side of the equation. Okay? Any question or thought here? Okay. All right, we push on. Verse 10. So the Lord said to Moses, go to the people and consecrate them today, tomorrow, and tomorrow. Have them wash their clothes. Be ready by the third day, because on that day the Lord will come down on Mount Sinai in the sight of all the people. Put limits for the people around the mountain. Tell them, be careful that you do not go up the mountain or touch the foot of it. Remember last week? There's going to be no bread out there on the Sabbath. Nevertheless, there goes a couple people looking for bread on the Sabbath. Do you remember? Okay. Don't go up the mountain. Okay. They need one of those electric collar fences. Because this has got to be a marvelous thing that's about to happen. Wouldn't you just want a little sneak peek? So maybe a little bit. Okay, I know you, Aaron, would be right next to the barrier, but you'd be like, we would want to see it, but you need to recognize. We want the people consecrated to recognize this is special. Clean your clothes, special. Okay, back in the day, you used to be able to say, put on your Sunday. Remember that? That was before we were liberated from all of those coats and ties. Oh, sorry. No offense. Okay. So be careful. You do not go to the mountain or touch the foot of it. Whoever touches the mountain shall surely be put to death. Verse 13. He shall surely be stoned or shot with arrows. Not a hand is to be laid on him. We're not going to lay our hand on him because we don't want us to be disqualified. So, whether man or animal, he shall not be permitted to live. Only when the ram's horn sounds a long blast may they go up to the mountain. So, here goes Moses. Moses had gone down the mountain to the people. He consecrated them, and they washed their clothes. Then he said to the people, prepare yourselves for the third day and abstain from sexual relations. Even there. This is special. Verse 16. On the morning of the third day, here it comes. I'm going to read slower. I usually read fast, but here we go. On the morning of the third day, there was thunder. Lightning. A thick cloud covered the mountain. A very loud trumpet blast. Everyone in the camp did what you would do if all of this was happening. They were trembling. Okay, now, one thing that happens, this is serious. This is really serious. Okay? How serious? Okay, I'm being funny, but I cleaned my clothes for this event. Okay? We consecrated the people to remind them of the gravity of the situation. Okay? This is a serious occasion. So, verse 17, Moses led the people out of the camp to meet with God, and they stood at the foot of the mountain. Mount Sinai was covered with smoke because the Lord descended on it in fire. Okay? Covered smoke. You can't see, but the Lord descends in fire. Notice 18. The smoke billowed up from it like the smoke from a furnace. The whole mountain trembled violently. All right. So we got enough people from California. You guys ever sit there washing the dishes and everything outside is moving and you can't figure out, why is everything moving out there?
You see the walls moving.
Exactly. You don't have perspective. Like, what's going on out there? You're shaking too, but you don't know it. Earthquake. I mean, it is a scary. I can't imagine. I cannot imagine. And the sound of the trumpet grew even louder. Whatever that thing is. Then Moses spoke, and the voice of God answered him. This is a high point. This is huge. A lot of wonderful things are happening. A lot of special things as God opens himself up this way. So verse 20. The Lord descended to the top of the mountain and called Moses to the top. Dun, 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 dun. Here he goes. Okay. He is moving on this mountain. So Moses went up, and the Lord said to him, go down. Okay. Go down and warn the people so they do not force their way through to see the Lord. Second warning. Even the priests who approach the Lord must consecrate themselves, or the Lord will break out against them. Like, what could he possibly do? Okay. Just think, what could he possibly do? I mean, he descends in fire himself. So, serious. 23. Moses said to the Lord, the people cannot come up Mount Sinai because you yourself warned us, put limits around the mountain and set it apart as holy. Yeah, but there could be somebody. Could be somebody. All right, last part of it. The Lord replied, see what you think about this one. Go down and bring Aaron up with you. Okay? Now, it's not Aaron's self-esteem that I'm looking for, but what does this do to Aaron in front of the nation?
It affirms him.
Yeah. So here, Aaron is now coming up. But the priests and the people must not force their way through to come up, or he will break out against them. So Moses went down to the people and told them such things. Okay, they come back up, Aaron is there. Everybody good? Do you see? This is setting the stage. This is setting the stage. Now we're going to move into, what is this covenant? What is this covenant? And what are its stipulations? Okay, covenant, a contractual agreement, if you will. We've got two parties, and the divine party here is about to tell us what's up. Any questions here in chapter 19? It's a good chapter for us to slow down because a lot of things are happening. I see that hand.
So is the implication that in 20, he's actually giving the commandments to Aaron and Moses?
That I don't know. It seems that Moses is enough, but the act right now here in 19 shows that Moses is, and then Moses is about to deliver the words. So it's gonna stick with Moses, but clearly Aaron got something.
So it could just be that Aaron went up, was affirmed, and then now it's, God is giving the commandments to Moses?
Yeah, I think so, but I don't know if I have enough to answer your question. But everything's going to come through Moses, and they're going to, again, step back and say, Moses. They're going to differentiate Moses for the rest of their Old Testament life. God's going to speak through the prophets. But even speaking through the prophets is second rate. Because how did God speak to Moses? To face to face. See that, so it's that component. It's not Aaron's face, so to speak. So that's why I'm saying, in effect, it's Moses. That's the major piece here. Any other? Yes, Taylor.
Is it at this point, like, I know that this is a theocracy where God is the leader, right? Is this kind of like setting it up big time for me, that he's the leader?
Yes.
No king, no that, it's him.
Yes.
Like
so the
spokesperson, Moses and Aaron, I guess.
Right. Yes. So it seems just in the bigger picture that we always have a human mediator, go between priest, as it were, serving to mediate God's theocratic kingdom. Yes. But now we're going to see it move into this national mode. You as a nation are to distribute how this moves out throughout the world. Okay?
It's almost like the triangle, the prophet, priest, and king, but in this one, I guess God's the king, and
yes.
Moses is the prophet. And
I don't disagree. Yes. But I don't know the relation. Okay? All right, let's take a look at these words here on the Ten Commandments. And God spoke all these words. And verse 2 of chapter 20, I am the Lord your God who brought you out of Egypt, out of the land of slavery. So notice how he contextualizes it. Don't forget, it's only been a couple chapters, but I'm the God that brought you out of Egypt. Okay, number 1, you shall have no other gods before me. Now, so we're working on the Ten Commandments, and we're doing a little research, and we come to find out that not everyone's Ten Commandments are the same. Have you guys noticed that over history? You got a background. I think it's in Catholic.
Yeah, they were different.
The Catholic Ten Commandments are different. They divide the covet, number 10, into two. Do not covet your neighbor's wife. 9. Do not cover his stuff. 10. That's a paraphrase. But they group 1 and 2. What's 1 and 2? You shall have no other gods before me. You shall not make yourself an idol. What they're doing is they're using make an idol to be the way that you put another god before me. So they collapse that one, and then they expand that one. So different Christian traditions will have different. The Lutherans seem to do that. There's another modification in Reform. Some Baptists will do something that's a little peculiar as well. But it's usually 1 and 2 is 1 and 2, one entity or the two. You got to split them somewhere else. Okay. All right. That said, enough of the survey of world religions. Notice how we're doing here. No other gods. No other gods. That's the call. That's the call. And they've had him specifically. So they've got very concrete material to go, I don't know if I want the other gods. Let's see. What did you do to the other gods? Exodus 12:12. He took care of all those so-called gods in Egypt. Okay? I alone am the Lord. Okay? He's the only one. Do not make for yourself an idol from anything in heaven above or on earth, beneath it, or in the waters. Again, this is another one that gets a lot of discussion because the church has now figured out, is this really against the arts in general? Hey, we'll put my alarm on here. Okay, that's to remind me, I want to jump somewhere. So I need to move quickly here for just a second. the fabrication of something that serves in the place of God. But you know, today we're so advanced, we don't have idols today. Okay, but watch what they're talking about again are the kinds of things that are like wood and stone, just okay, idols. But we have our own today. And they do usurp the place that's only for God. And that's really hard. That's really hard. Let me just give you one in Jesus' speech. You can't serve God and mammon. You can't. Now, I think we all might come to a place where we think we can, well, you know, just a little bit, okay? But none of that rivalry. God is jealous. God is a jealous God. Verse 7, do not misuse the name. Okay, again, I think we think in terms of current application. We put his name in a place where all of a sudden we're not using it right. Misuse. Number 4, the Sabbath. The Sabbath is yet another one. It doesn't seem like there's consensus in the church on what this one, how it should be worked out today, or should it be worked out today, or it is worked out today, we just work it out on a different day. Okay, well, all of those are complications. Like, the first one I would ask, if we're going to keep the Sabbath, is what day is the Sabbath? Okay, what are you doing on that day? Because I know what you're going to do on the first day of the week as a Christian. You see? Well, there was a transference. Again, was that explained to us? Okay, now I'm also tipping my hat at something that I want to hit. That's why I set my alarm. So I need to move faster. Do not murder. And the word is actually kill, but it's clearly violence. We're going to make stipulations. I mean, the men of war are going to kill. We're going to have, remember, manslaughter. We're going to have these cities of refuge. You need to flee to the city of refuge. If you don't get to the city of refuge on time, and what's that guy's name? The Avenger of Death comes and he catches you. Do you know what he's allowed to do? This word. Okay? But it's not murder. So we know we got to qualify. What does this mean? It's not just generic kill, but there will be some killing. Commit adultery. Again, I think this is with specific reference to the marriage covenant. That doesn't free, if you're not married, you're free to do whatever. Okay? But within this thing, we're talking about taking shots at things that are going to deteriorate this community, this Israelite community. And this is one along that line. Don't give false testimony. Again, this is probably reserved for that legal function in a court. Doesn't mean you can lie when you're not in court. Just the case looks like if you come in and you bear false witness, let's see. What could we bear false witness? Well, there's an episode where false witness has been born. Oh, I know. The crucifixion that resulted from the trial of Jesus. They were looking for people to make up stuff. They couldn't find any. Oh, hold on. I remember he said this. I'm going to destroy the temple. Remember that one? Okay. Remember, the witnesses can't even agree with themselves. All right. So I think there's a legal component. I want to read the last one. You shall not covet your neighbor's house. Shall not covet your neighbor's wife. His manservant, his maidservant, his ox or donkey, or anything that belongs to your neighbor. And it's interesting here that for me that the neighbor is in here a couple of times. And I think we all understand what covetousness. And it's an internal thing. It's an attitude. You know, you turn green with, we get those kind of concepts. But it's interesting, by using neighbor here multiple times, I think we're also to be hearing, I'm doing something wrong to my neighbor when I do this. And I don't know if that's in our calculus all the time. Like, I don't want to be covetous. I don't want to enter into this what you have versus what I have, because I am in some way attacking you. Right? What way? Well, I don't care about you is probably the chief way. It's like, remember, a thief can say stuff like this. You know what? What's mine is mine, and what's yours is mine. I don't care about you, okay? You're the irrelevant one. And I'm only framing this one just by way of application for us. By way of application. It's not that I don't covet It would be enough to say, I don't covet because God told me not to covet. But I think through it to say, I'm doing something that makes you insignificant in the process so that I can go and take what's yours with no care about you at all. In this community, I'm not taking your marriage partner. I'm not bearing false witness against you in court. I'm not stealing. I'm not going to just, so I can take all that's yours. I'm not desirous of those that aren't mine. I'm satisfied with God and what He has given me. Okay? Because I don't want to be an offense to you. I don't want to be an offense to you. All right. These are some of the concepts with these Ten Commandments. Watch how they respond. When the people saw the thunder and the lightning, they heard the trumpet and saw the mountain in smoke, they trembled with fear. They stayed at a distance and said to Moses, speak to us yourself. Don't let God speak straight. Speak to us yourself and we will listen. But do not have God speak to us or we will die. Moses said to the people, do not be afraid. God has come to test you so that the fear of God. Remember testing last week? I test sometimes to get you to the next level. I want you to pass the test, not fail. He's testing you. This is serious. Your commitment is serious here. We will do whatever he says. They've already said that. So that the fear of God will be with you to keep you from sinning. The fear of God. Can the fear of God keep you from sinning? I think it can. If you have a realistic picture. How realistic? How about the next time you're about to sin, thunder and lightning, smoke, fire, God descending. Are you serious? Serious. And we need a dose of that ourselves to remember our commitments are serious. Our commitments to the Lord are serious. Our commitments to our spouse are serious. Our commitments to Jesus are serious. I committed to do something for the Lord and I'm failing to follow through. These things are serious things. Okay? If you're not going to do it, then ask the Lord to take that from you. Submit to Him. But I'm just telling you, I think we just tamp down these commitments to our neighbors, our community, our Sunday school class as a way to do that. Any question right here? I saved myself 15 minutes, which means we're going overtime. Any questions here? Okay, here's the problem. The real problem is, what is the Christian's relationship to the Ten Commandments? This is a real question. And I come from a real theological background that says, this is a real question that trips a lot of people up. What is the Christian's perspective with respect to the Ten Commandments? And I would make the case for you if I get time. Well, you got 4 minutes. If I had time to just say, I don't think it's as immediate or as direct as we might often think it is. Now, I'm a what we call a dispensationalist. I just want to say that again because I'm such a proud one. No, I come from a theological stream that looks at some of these things in ways that see what God did for Israel is unique and distinct and theirs. And I don't just take what's theirs and say, oh, and it's mine too. I don't pretend that I was at that mountain and saying everything he says I will do as a Christian today. But that's what they did. And from here on out, from chapter 21, 22, 23, all the way through Leviticus, we're going to find out what are the stipulations to this covenant. And they're huge. What's the book of Leviticus about? Right. But we don't do those things today. Well, hold on. If it's mine, Why don't I do those things? Now, you guys know the answer is Jesus is the answer to those things. But I think the question is wrong-headed because you're usurping data that wasn't. This is a covenant relationship, okay? Let me just, a legal binding document, if you will, between God and the nation Israel. It is no more the place for me to come into your house and take, let's just say, your deed for your house and say, this is my deed. Now, there are things, I think they are whatever, I'm not a legal person. I do not have a litigious nature. But you would need more law to get me written into this law. It's possible. It's possible. I could get written into your deed and, oh, I don't know, whatever, pay your rent for you, whatever. It's possible. But you have to, but you have to have legal document to just do this. You can't just take someone else, you know what? Where's your marriage certificate? I'm married to Meredith now.
Uh-huh.
I would need a lot more legal documents.
The Avengers coming.
Okay? Yeah. Do you understand? This is what's happening. A covenant is being formed with this nation. Okay? All right. I want to just do take you to two verses, maybe three. Let's jump to James chapter 2. James chapter 2. In James chapter 2, and this is the first one, in verse 10. Watch what for whoever keeps the whole law and yet stumbles at just one point, how much is he guilty of? All of it. Okay? So let's just say I'm under the Ten Commandments. It's not just the Ten Commandments that came to these people. Exodus 22, 23, 24, 25, 26, Leviticus 1, 2, okay? Jump over to Galatians. Galatians 5, verse 3. Listen. Again, I declare to every man who lets himself be circumcised that he's obligated to obey the whole law. Remember in Galatia, the Jewish people were trying to influence the Christians to say, you need to be circumcised. And Paul's saying to them, if you do that, you're obligated to keep the whole thing. The law comes as an indivisible unity. It's a whole package. The fine print is in Leviticus, but you're bound by the words in the fine print too. You can't just pick and choose. All right, let me give you one more. One more, and it's in 1 Corinthians 9. 1 Corinthians 9. Okay, I'm giving you one more, but I'm going to read another one just because I can. Listen to this. This is Romans 6. For sin shall not be your master, because you are not under law, but under, anybody? Grace. There's a different aegis over us. In history, Israel was put under this ruling system, law. In Christ, you are under this ruling system, grace. Listen to the language. You are not under law, under grace. You are under grace. Okay? Now, that's about as clean a statement as I can get. What's my position toward the law? Listen. You are not under the law. You're under grace. Oh. But don't I have to obey the law? Okay, listen again. You're not under the law. Okay? In 1 Corinthians 9, I want you to see Paul and how he reconciles himself here. Look at verse 19. Though I am free and belong to no man, I make myself a slave to everyone to win as many as possible. To the Jews, I become like a Jew to win the Jews. To those under the law, I become like one under the law, though I myself am not under the law. Do you guys see that line right there? Okay. Question, Paul's ethnicity? He's a Jew. Okay. The Jew, Paul says, I have to become Jew because I am not under the law. Do you see it? That is weird. Because I thought he was a Jew. Okay, push on. Notice this one. Verse 21. To those not having the law, I became like one not having the law. What? To the Gentile who doesn't have the law, I also become like them so I can win Gentiles. I become like one not under the law. Hold on, that might mean too much. Read the parenthetical statement real quick. Notice what it says right after that. Though technically I'm not free from God's law, I am under Christ's law. And that's different. What's the difference? Christ's law and Moses' law aren't the same thing. And Paul is bound by one of those, not the other. So what I would suggest when we read 1 Corinthians 9, 20 and 21 is Paul is really moving to accommodate both groups. But how can he do that? You're either in the law or the not law. If you're in the not law, then you don't have to become like not law. You're in that group. Okay? What I would suggest is when Paul came to Christ, just like you, when you came to Christ, you became in a new group. And you have to change, Paul's telling you, I have to change to be law-like Jew to reach Jews. And I have to change to be lawless Gentile to reach those not under the law. Are you following what I'm saying? He's in a third position. And that's right. In Christ, we're in a third position. There's a reason why we're not in law. We are, notice how the language in verse 21, we are in law to Christ. And that's a different rule. And that's the rule we're under. So as Christians, I just want to drive that home to remind you. In Christ, we're in a different position. And our reason for not saying we're under the law, well, Paul says that. But it's because we're in a better place. We are in law to Christ through the Spirit. And that's what the New Testament teaches us in our Christian conduct. Okay. Now, for me, it's worth the time to just get that on the table because this is probably one of the areas in Christian living that is the most confusing. We've got all of these laws. Right. I would just tell you, when you encounter Christ, live by His teaching. Pastor Daniel worked really hard today to get that across. Whatsoever I have commanded. You remember that? Matthew 28. So they're to teach whatever I've commanded in that process. And that is a huge thing. We can tease this out on another day. Maybe chew it over lunch or something. Gnaw on me. But I just want you to have a perspective. It's a break from that Mosaic law that was used to stipulate the nature of the covenant they were in. But we have been covenanted to Christ, and that's a different thing. It doesn't mean the Old Testament is a waste of time. Otherwise, we shouldn't have picked Exodus. But what it means is, whatever the Old Testament does, I always have to filter through Christ before it hits me. And that is a huge hermeneutical grab for you. Let's pray, and then we'll take off. Father, we give you thanks for an opportunity to look at your word. We pray that it would shape us, inform us. We pray that we'd have eyes to see even the members of our class in a way that appreciates their dignity, treats them as they are before you, the image of God. Pray that our awareness of the people around us, Lord, would increase in a way that we would take care not to defraud our brothers, not to cheat our brothers. Lord, might we instead replace all the doing that the law required with what you ask us, to love our neighbors. So might you put a positive spin on the way that we perceive our relationships within the class, within the church, within our own families. Lord, might you be glorified in what you see. Might we treat you with reverence and gravity that you deserve. You're a kind God. You've worked in such special and personal ways. We just bless your name because you are good. We pray in Jesus' name. Amen.